please. Be seated, please.
Assalamu alaikum, Hazur.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Hazur, today we have five guests, and I shall start with my immediate right. Hazur, Mr. Lutz Herman is the Vice President of the Foreign Press Association in London. Mm-hmm. He represents one of the largest daily newspapers in Germany, which has a circulation of about 500,000. And he has been...
Which happens to be?
Which is...
In Düsseldorf.
In Düsseldorf.
West Germany.
That's right, yes.
And he has been in Britain for 7 years. Next to Mr. Herman is Keith Wakely. Keith Wakely is a professional photographer who again supplies photographs to the newspaper industry.
Haven't we met before?
We have met before, yes. That's right. And he is also photographed the royal family. Mm-hmm. Next to him we have Rodney Lamborn. Rodney Lamborn is an accountant by profession, but he also practices photography and has been involved with that. Mm-hmm. He currently works for a major oil company. Next to him we have James Hilton. Mm-hmm. James Hilton is traveled around the world with a family and has now settled in this country and is currently a teacher.
Most welcome. Thank you for coming.
So I'd ask Mr. Herman to start us off.
Thank you very much for having the opportunity. What bothers me, or what I'm interested in, is your opinion about young people. Young people in Europe, young people in the world. I have the impression from time to time that more and more young people are turning away from religions and saying the materialistic, the capitalist way of life, because it is an easier way. What is your opinion about this fear?
My opinion is that I am more worried about the old people who gave birth to these young people and who brought them up. It's their neglect of responsibilities which is being reflected in these young people. The older generation always loses interests in God and godly things first. And then this interest is quietly transferred to the younger generations. Because they know exactly what their parents are interested in. And the parents think their children are innocent, they do not know. So their word is different and their act is different. Their conduct is different. They tell them to be good, pious, God-fearing and whatever. And the children know they themselves are not. So that is why my concern is for the older generations rather than the younger generations, which follow the natural law. They could not opt for anything else.
Your Holiness, following the tragedy of the death of Diana, the Princess of Wales, and Dodi Fayed, there was a considerable outpouring of grief from the people of England in particular to both families, the Spencer family and the Fayed family. Would you take this as a sign that the English people have accepted now that we are a multicultural society? And the second part of my question is, had this young couple come along to you to suggest that they intended to marry, what would your advice have been to both of them, particularly to Diana, as a daughter and as a public figure? What would you have said to her?
Turning to the first part of your question, I believe that Diana, being a very beautiful lady, was popular just because of A, her beauty, and her belonging to the royal family. So as such she was a popular figure among the common people of England. In fact she was more popular among the commoners than the big people. And when they saw the reaction of the commoners of England, so much of such deep grief, they had no choice but to follow them. So whatever I read of the reaction, read of the sense of bereavement after her death, I found it different in this way, that the people were genuine in their grief. The elders were not genuine, because I found many among them who had severely criticized Diana prior to her death, but they dared not open their mouth again. So this is exactly as I find the situation of her death. As far as the question of her proposed marriage is concerned, I don't think that could have been any success at all. So God has covered, in a way, thrown a curtain across the face of the future, which might have been very ugly. So, knowing Diana as I do, as I thought I did, I think this marriage could not have been successful. Because Diana was a girl who was in search of a perfect match of her highest ambitions. And I do not think that such a match existed in the world. Particularly the Arab princes are so differently made that very soon Diana should have discovered that it was just an infatuation and not love which she had discovered. So that again is no sign of anybody's racialism or the opposite, the lack of racialism. This issue is not related to this issue at all. But because Diana thought he was good, so people had to accept her to sin. So it doesn't show that they have changed their attitude towards race, and they changed their attitude against the Arabs. They just followed their popular leader Diana, and that was all. Please.
Your Holiness, it is 50 years now since England opened its doors to worldly immigrants. During that time, the country has changed dramatically in attitude to people of all races. Do you think that because of the...
Please, the first part of your question was not very clear to me.
It is 50 years now since England opened its doors widely to immigrants.
It's 50 years.
Huh?
It's 50 years since England opened its door for immigrants.
Right.
During that time, the country has changed dramatically in its attitude to people of all races. Do you think that because of the size of this country, that it would be now acceptable to cease immigration for a period of several years until every citizen was living a reasonable standard?
In my opinion, nothing has changed. Some attitudes have appeared on surface which were suppressed before. With all the due apologies to the British people, I must admit that according to my study, the British, because of a long rule of colonialism and imperial traditions, had always suppressed this snobbish attitude against the non-British. They were compelled to suppress it because of the political situation of the world, because of the communism, you know, and the threat of communism against the common people. So they had to suppress these things. But after the communist empire exploded. There was no further reason for them to keep it really suppressed. But a long history of anti-racist sermons and speeches, etc., could not permit them to make a sharp turn and a clear, evident turn. That was one reason why anti-racist views are spread, are still spread in the society and still prevalent in the society. There is another reason why anti-racist views are not promoted or encouraged. It is because of the Jewish influence over the society. Because they know once racism raises its ugly head, it will strike against the Jewish people and their interest as well. So that is why these two factors join hands together to make the voice of racism suppressed. But the internal psychic reaction remains the same. British people can accept the Jews because they really consider them not as Palestinians, but as belonging to the West. And it is their Western habit and culture and their long domination of the Western countries, which was not liked, of course, but their presence was, of course, known as being a Westerner people. So that factor all brings the Jewish people closer to the society. But still the Jews are deeply afraid of racism. So these are the factors, I believe, which would not permit the British people to react against the non-British openly. But at the same time, they do react. They do not like their overmuch presence and interference in their politics. Although the Labour Party has a different attitude from the conservative thinking of the British, and it is permitting more role, political role, to the non-Britishers to play in their politics. But I believe that is only for the sake of votes, for no other reason. So that too is meaningless. They, I believe, themselves realize that the spread of overmuch influence of the non-British is not good for them. These are the factors which are becoming more and more apparent now. But also there are factors which are economic factors, which always play an important role in British economy, but you want to benefit from them without paying the price for them. The non-British labor is cheaper, and a large number of them are unauthorized immigrants. And again, the people from many Afro-Americans, I mean, from Colombia, etc., and West Indies, people from African countries, although they are given equal rights in their labor, but because they cannot find job opportunities easily, so they lower their price themselves. So this is a factor which the British economists really understand, and they permit it to happen. So these are the reasons why very stiff measures against the immigrants cannot be taken. So the British decision makers are undecided between the two things. yet it is impossible for them to throw out immigrants altogether or to suppress their inflow altogether. As far as the inflow is concerned, it cannot be suppressed because there are many loopholes through which the people go on entering. But in future, one thing is possible, that more and more Western countries, Eastern countries can be resisted by new legislations and discouraged by new legislations. That is possible, and I think that is happening in the society nowadays. But these Africans, etc., they are less difficult to be suppressed because you have your own traditional relationship with them and you're bound to leave some doors open for them. And that is exactly what's happening these days. Have I covered all the parts of your question?
Yes, you have. Thank you.
Hazrat, I would like to know your views on the idea of reincarnation.
Have you started seriously contemplating the concept of reincarnation?
I've had friends who have seriously contemplated the idea of reincarnation. They seem pretty convinced.
As far as the full treatment of this subject is concerned, after this session is over, I'm going to present to you my latest book on revelation, rationality, etc. This covers this aspect of reincarnation, I think, completely, comprehensively. And it's impossible for me to raise all the points which I have raised and discussed in this book here, because it would take more than an hour or so, at least more than an hour or so, to cover everything. In short, I believe the Western tendency in believing in some sort of reincarnation is because they want to live, to continue to live, like every human does. It's a psychological compulsion that everything which exists and has some consciousness of its existence wants to continue to stick to that consciousness of existence. This is what I say, continuity. This is what life is. Now, as such, they want to live, but they do not want to be answerable to God. So the only escape is in the direction of reincarnation. But little do they understand about reincarnation. They just hear of it, and because of some parapsychologists who speak of some experiences of their forefathers having appeared, or someone appearing in going to a castle and saying, yes, I have been here before, you know, that sort of thing. That helps them being in, that encourages them to continue to hope for reincarnation. But these are the positive points. There are negative points as well. According to the true philosophy of reincarnation, most often the person who is human will not be born as a human again. He is very likely to be born as a dog in the next generation or as a worm. As such, the more sinful that person is, the more likely he is to be degraded in his life to come. Now, as we know, these people escape answerability because they know they are sinful. And knowing themselves to be sinful, they would dare not, if they really know, be born again as worms. What is the fun of that continuity of life? Life here was gorgeous. They could do anything they liked. They could enjoy anything as humans. But to be born again as just small things, animals or worms, etc., that is not what they would love to be. And that is why you should, the Westerners, those who ask you this question, they should be made to understand all the implications of reincarnation. Thank you. Please. Patricia.
So I wanted to know, some people would say that Islam is a man's religion and that 1400 years ago women were given rights because they were dependent on men. But now that time has moved on and things have changed, women aren't so dependent on men, they can work for themselves. How can you reassure me that there is equality among the sexes?
The question seems to be a short question, but it requires a very large answer, in fact.
I have many other questions.
Yes. The fact is that what liberty Islam gives to women is not time-bound, nor is it space-bound. That liberty is eternal. And it also is needed by women today, because that liberty is withheld from women by even the most, let me say, for the greatest advocates of women's liberty. They themselves do not offer them this liberty. First of all, let me remind you that women up till that time were treated as possession by all the societies of the world. They were possessions, only they became great things as idols, not in reality. In reality, the societies where these women idols grew, they themselves treated women as just slaves and as their possession, as I have already said. So the first thing which happened in the world, which was so noteworthy because it was historic, epoch-making, that was that the Quran declared women not to be a possession of men. And they were treated equal in their rights to rights against men. And men were treated equal in their rights against women. Now this is the most difficult point to understand for some Westerners, because they think that Islam treats men with greater rights than women. This is not true. Islam repeatedly speaks of equal rights of men and women in everything. Only there are some constitutional differences which cannot be done away with. Women are constitutionally made different from men. So even the most eloquent advocate of women's lib cannot devise a way in which women can make men pregnant with their babies. It's not possible. So this requires a very special teaching. To keep into view all their rights as pregnant women or the future mothers of the future generation. As such, constitutionally, they also have to maintain the house and take care of the household things and cooking, etc., etc., which is no different in Western society than all other societies of the world. So keeping these things in view, one requires that a perfect teaching should also have regard to these constitutional differences. If it does not, it cannot be declared as a teaching of equal rights, because the rights are related to constitutions. As so often I have pointed out that if a lady, however strong she may be, is required to compete in a boxing match with a man who is the champion of boxing, what would you think would happen?
I think she'd get beaten up.
Beaten to pulp, to nothingness maybe. Why, if they're equal? They're equal in rights, in the sense that their constitutional potentials must be kept in view when you make them compete with each other. So this is what you do in a Western society as well, while it is not because of any religious influence. It is the reality of life which has dawned upon you that this talk of equal rights is just rubbish, unless you pay special attention to these inevitable inequalities. So Islam pays attention to these, and that is why you find different teachings regarding women and men, but only in those areas where they are constitutionally different. So in short, I think that should be the answer to your question. But I have spoken of this in detail at much greater length and with some depth in other question and answer sessions, which cover almost everything about this. So if you are interested in learning more, you could perhaps contact the Imam Sahib, and he would be able to provide you with audio or video cassettes as you please.
Again, young generation, but my question is more relations of the young generation, young people, and television. Observing television here, yes, in Great Britain, observing in France the television where I lived some years, and observing the television in Germany, I found that television is showing more and more films of great violence, aggressive sex, and other things which you can bear, which you can't bear to see. Do you think, because experts are not sure whether those films influence the young people or not, some say yes, some say no, what is your opinion about the influence of television concerning those programs?
Yes, I believe that the television companies have very little choice to make, because they are money-minded people. And because it is the material world which rules today, wherever they will find money, they will accept that, regardless of whether it's good for the people or bad for the people. They are not custodians of our morals. They used to be once, long ago, because this media, radio, television media, when it just came into being At that time, the people who took care of these things were moral, more moral in their own attitude, or at least they behaved like moral people in whatever they gave to the public. But no more so. A competition began in which more filth you offered, more money you would earn. And this competition went on unchallenged. And because of this growing evil influence, the people also went down the drain. And more they became evil themselves and less careful of morality, the more they accepted this media. In fact, in their private lives, they would rather have such films as you call sheer filth than other films of responsibility. So this is not only this is not the only problem. Some televised programs show give the warning that children should not be shown this program. But first of all, who cares for that warning? If the children are awake or if they know what's happening, they may see to it that they're awake at that time. At least the youngsters are conscious of this. Not the small children, but the youngsters. They are now they are gradually being more inclined towards watching these programs. So it's not just sex which is so dangerous. It is violence which runs along with sex. The more violence they show on television, the more pleased the viewers become. And more excited they become, they get more kick out of such programs. So with the result that they have a quiet message that violence is good. If it's not against you, but if you become violent against others. So everybody thinks that violence is one-sided. While it is not one-sided, the society becomes violent to the benefit of some and to the disadvantage of others, but to the disadvantage of the society as a whole. So that is why you see more violence in the streets these days, more murders, more ruthlessness. So these are all the influences of this modern media, which is called media of instruction. And again, it's very damaging for the children who are shown imaginary things prepared out of computers. You see, gone are the days when cartoons, etc., used to be real. And you know, pictures like those of, you know, what was that American humor artist? Huh? Quite famous.
Donald Duck.
Huh?
Donald Duck, no?
No, not Donald Duck. No. The artist.
Huh?
Disney.
Oh, Disney.
Disney used to be realistic in the early days. But Charlie Chaplin.
Ah, right. Of course.
You know, all his films are natural acting. Mm-hmm. And he does make us laugh even today.
Yeah.
But no more of that. Mm-hmm. Now you must take the new generation into fantasies, into an unreal world of color and lines which you believe to be real hobgoblins or visitors from the space and so on and so forth. So that is one part of this new trend of media which is damaging the attitude of the younger generations, of children particularly, mm-hmm. who really believe in these things as real. And although later on, when they return to their normal thinking through education, they may seem to get rid of it, I'm quite sure that the impressions you receive in early age are always lasting. So they live in a world mixed with reality and unreality. And they would always like to create unreality and dream of unreality. Their ambitions may be of the same hollow nature. So I believe personally that it is doing a lot of damage to children. Moreover, the other damage which I am extremely worried about is that greater trend of people to move away from reading to television. Television offers a cheap source of seeking pleasure, but it's not always knowledgeable. Reading, even when it is fiction, mm-hmm. is far more knowledgeable. Read the classical English book novels and you'll be amazed that of course, the whole drama was fiction, the whole story and its make was fiction. But fiction woven out of realities of that life had existed in England in those days. So, it's a strange mixture of reality with fiction in which the impression you receive is that of reality, mm-hmm. not of fiction at all. Mm-hmm. So it's quite the opposite of what I have just told you about the modern trends in the film industry, in the television industry. So I would much rather like a younger generation to return to the reading habit. It's very constructive. And it also less wasteful of your time. So, I believe that could be some answer to this. But unfortunately, the modern books which are being written for the sake of children, etc., they are also fictitious books. Mm-hmm. Fictitious in the sense that they present life as unreal. And children also have more interest in that. So there's a lot of house cleaning to be done for us. Quite some lot of house cleaning. Thank you.
Thank you. My father died last autumn.
Your pardon?
My father died last autumn. And amongst the people that offered sympathy, I had two Muslim friends. And the one, who's a member of this association, Nazim Ghari, came to the house and expressed sympathy and prayed with us.
That's very good.
But a neighbor two doors down announced, "Your father has gone to hell." It was the first thing he
who
said.
Who was this
and
man?
I thought he's English.
Who was this hell-bound person?
So I said to him, "No, Ramsey, no, in England we say he's gone to heaven." I thought his English was probably, it was mixed up. And he said, "Oh, no, no, he's gone to hell." And he was adamant that he had gone to hell. It would appear that this is some of the teaching, perhaps, of the Quran.
You see, according to the Holy Quran,
yes.
I'll give you an answer in principle. According to the Holy Quran, man is warned against some evil acts which may lead to hell. But according to the Holy Quran, God will decide who should go to hell and who should not. The Holy Quran promises that God can forgive every sin and all sins, leaving none aside. If he so decide, he can forgive. So who is there in the world to dictate to God to whom he should put to hell and to whom he should not? So this is why I said he himself is hell-bound, because he is... acting as God. Fact.
Yes.
And this is one crime which is unforgivable. That is what I said, he is hell-bound, because if you act God, you call yourself as an equal to him. And to call oneself equal to God is an unforgivable crime according to the Holy Quran.
I will be pleased to tell him.
Thank you.
Yes. What policies or changes would you introduce if you were Prime Minister of this country to have a better integrated society, whether it be economic or social?
What advice would I render?
Sorry?
Do you mean what advice I would render to the policy, economic policy makers?
Whether it be economic or social or both.
Yes. I think it's useless to try to render any advice to them, because they are controlled by such motives as are beyond their control themselves. It's very important to note that the central philosophy of the economy of all the advanced nations is that money must flow from other countries to them. At whatever cost, they do not care. At whatever social cost or the cost of the extreme poverty of the people from whom the money is flowing towards the rich people, that is not their concern at all. But they cannot advise any foreign, any economic policy to reverse the flow. It's impossible. So why should I render any advice to them when they cannot follow? The social factors are related to this question.
So I'd like to ask a question regarding the phenomenon of ghosts.
Ghosts.
As in, do they exist? And if they do, can Islam offer any insight into it?
Well, I cannot rule them out altogether. But the ghosts, if you mean by the word ghost, the spirit of a deceased person, living around us,
an apparition
and haunting a house, that I do not believe in. But ghosts in the sense of genie, that is also a very debatable point. But I believe there does exist a form of life which can be ethereal and which can make itself appear to people like apparition, not in their reality. Such apparitions are known to have appeared to many people who are not superstitious. And such apparitions are known to have appeared to people bringing along with them the evidence of their existence in a manner that you cannot deny. So it's only because of this that I believe in this sort of phenomenon. I think it is essential for our belief in angels as well. Because if we poo-poo this idea and discard it as unreal, simultaneously will not have faith in the reality of angels either. So God has created balances in the world. As such, this type of existence must be there. Although it may not interfere with human life. That is another issue which has to be made clear. I do not believe that except for angels who are specifically told by God to do service to mankind, other such ghost-like things can do disservice to mankind. That is only superstition. They cannot interfere with anybody's real life. They just appear by way of making the belief that these things do exist. Now here I can quote my own example myself. Anybody who knows me would believe that what I'm telling is truth. Many a time I experienced this myself in a manner that it was impossible to reject it as just superstition on my part, because others were also involved in this. Now, out of many such experiences, I am going to quote one which can be testified by many living people today in the world. Once in Karachi, we decided to go for a picnic to the seaside, and as I thought of taking my recorder which I had given for repair, so I requested my hosts to go via a certain street where that shop happened to be. Now they stopped the car by the corner, and I went into the shop to find out if the repair had been completed or not. Now, as we were entering that street and turning in the direction of the shop, at the corner across the road, there was a woman standing with a burqa like Ahmadiyya burqa style, with eyes open and just standing there. Now, I was amazed to see something in her eyes which disturbed me deeply, because she had a look which was unreal. So I told my companions that I think I have seen this girl, and I thought at that time, but she seems strange to me. I didn't tell them I thought it was unreal, but I said I thought I knew that girl because her facial expression was familiar, but she looked strange. Now when I entered, this is the background of the whole thing to follow. When I entered the shop, I came out of it to see, to tell the people waiting for me in the car. There was one owner of the car who was driving, one small baby, about 4 years old, and one mother. They were all sitting in the car when I had left the car for the shop. So I came out to just wave to them, all right, wait, please. I was amazed to see that the woman, the mother of the child, had gone to that lady whom I had seen and was talking to her. And the child was looking, you know, at the mother as she was talking to her. And then I also saw another person appear from the other side of the road who came to close to that lady as though he was related. And at that time, the driver of the car also went out and started talking to him. Now both were busy talking to each other. And the little child in the car was looking with amazement what was happening. So I went back to the shopkeeper and retrieved my, which was audio, some device at that time used to be available, and returned to the car. And as I returned to the car, they were all back in the car. So I inquired from this girl, this lady, if she had known that woman. She said, "What do you mean? I have no idea who she is. And I turned to the husband of that lady and said, "Didn't you see some relative of that woman come, and didn't you go and talk to him?" He said, "No, I never left the car." But that was not all. He said, "Don't play with us. You went to the lady and the husband and you talked to both of them." So that is the strange part. If it was just my imagination, it would have been a different thing. They were also experienced something bizarre, while I had never left the door of the shop at all. They saw me go towards that lady and that husband or some relative, and they told me that all this time you were talking to them and I were waiting for you to return. Now this is a view. This is something which can be viewed from two different angles, and both are experienced the same. But hallucination maybe, but with different experience altogether. So this is the sort of experience which I told you I have gone through myself, and I still can't understand what happened. I could have imagined, maybe, I know I'm not that type of person, but why exactly the opposite was being imagined by these, by the hosts of mine who were sitting in the car. So when we were talking and I was telling them, no, don't tell me a lie, I remain in the shop and you went out, the little girl shouted, she used to call me uncle. He said, "Uncle, don't play with us, I myself saw you." "I saw you myself, so you can't cheat me." This is a strange thing. So that, I think, answers your question satisfactorily. Mm-hmm. I don't believe in hobgoblin things, but I believe there is some sort of form of existence which is specifically created by Allah to give message to some people that other than angels, things do exist which seem to be unreal to you. Right?
Thank you.
Yes, please.
So,
2 minutes and 15 seconds, so it should be a short question.
Okay. It's about the separation of men and women. And I was thinking that sometimes this can create a kind of nervousness amongst women of the men. They're kind of ill at ease when men are about. And I wondered, it's not perhaps very healthy.
Could you help me understand this question?
She's talking about the segregation of men and women.
Yes, that I understood.
And she said that
but
sometimes women...
What did she follow it?
Well, I'm not quite sure because the question is not constructed properly.
I tried to do it quickly, sorry. basically, I get the feeling that sometimes women are nervous of the men. And this is perhaps not a very healthy feeling. It's born out of...
Some women are nervous of all men or some men?
I've just picked up a general feeling of it being ill at ease and possibly...
I find some women aggressively interested in men. So it's both ways. When the society has become promiscuous, such things do happen and are expected to happen. And this promiscuousness is doing damage to the peace of society all over the free world. So I don't want to indulge in the detailed analysis of this because the time is only a few seconds left. I'm sorry, I do believe that if you ponder over the question from all sides, all angles, you will conclude the same thing as I have concluded, that this promiscuousness in the society is not good.
Mm.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. And I would like now, I have yet to give you some presents. This is a book which I have signed myself, but I told somebody else to write your names and just a word of regards. So this is not an artificial science studio. Mr. Lutz.
Mr. Lutz.
Yes.
Lutz. Thank you very, very Please. Much. Thank you very, very much. Well. Mr. Hammond wanted a photograph of the thing for his record.
Now what is this? Mr. Keith Wosley. And this one, I think, has to be the next one.
That's right.
This for you, please. Thank you.
James Hilton.
And this is for you, James. Oh, it's all right. Right. And this is for you. And now two left for your hosts.
Sorry.
One for Rafiq Hayat and
yes.
One for you.
Yes.
This for you, please.
That is for me.
And this for you. So I hope you will find time to read this book, but it requires some concentration. Because there are so many subjects which may be out of your area of interest. But I have tried to make them interesting for a person whose subject it is not. I mean, if you go through it with patience, I think you will be rewarded. Thank you.
Mr. Herman just wanted a picture of the whole
thing. Oh, of course, I will. Come on.
With this, please.
Is there a cameraman?
There's a camera. He's bought it on camera that he wanted.
Okay, beautiful.